Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Dear brothers and sisters, welcome to another episode of Living with the Names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and with our guest speaker, Dr. Hassan Alwan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. My pleasure to be with all of you today. Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. It's always, a unique opportunity to have you and to have the chance to have these kind of conversations with you. Subhanallah, you know, one of the most fascinating conversations that a believer can have is a conversation that has to do with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with our creator, with our beloved creator who loves us subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in this series, which we're going to maintain inshallah, have it every other week inshallah ta'ala, my dear brothers and sisters, dear viewers out there, we're going to be exploring the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Reflect on the beauty and the deep meanings within these names and attributes. And at the same time, also the effect of the names of Allah azza wa jalla, understanding them and the effects of these names in our lives, inshallah ta'ala. Last time we had you, Dr. Hassan Alwan, it was, we talked about, just living with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or living in accordance to, we brought up the hadith, Bismik Allahumma amutu ahya, or Allahumma bika amsayna wa bika asbahna. So with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what I find, to be very fascinating, all the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are very powerful. They're mentioned in the Quran. To me, one of the most fascinating names is actually the name itself, Allah, right? Which is a proper noun. Some say that it's derivative from al-ilah, and then it became Allah. And others say, it's a proper noun, name that Allah azza wa jalla has chosen for himself. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions it. It's mentioned in the hadith, the prophets and the messengers refer to him as Allah. Some say that the meaning of it is the God, or with a capital G. And it's mentioned in the Quran, close to 2,699 times, right? And there is one surah that is the name Allah is mentioned in every single verse. This is a trivia question for our audience, inshallah. If you know which surah it is, you can always comment or put it in the type it down in the comment section, inshallah ta'ala. There's one surah in the Quran where the name Allah appears in every single ayah. But this name, my dear brother Hassan, if I may ask you, just has a very powerful impact. Even the shape of it when it's written, it's very powerful. I remember one of my teachers used to, whenever the name Allah is mentioned, he used to have a reaction to it. Like you would feel that it would shake him, right? So what would be the effect of this name? What should be the effect of this name, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on the believer in his daily life?
SubhanAllah. Jazakumullah khair, Sheikh, for this wonderful introduction. And I would say the following. I completely agree with you. Whenever we speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you tell someone that loves someone, speak about your beloved, what happens? He smiles, he can't stop speaking, yeah. He can spend hours and hours and hours, and this conversation can, because we're happy. And this is exactly how I feel, like when we meet and we're talking about who? Allah.
Allah.
I am talking about Allah. No one living on this planet, spinning around its axis like a bullet in space, and I have the ability to speak about the source of wisdom, the source of knowledge, the most powerful, I get excited. Yeah. So the first thing is if there is a true feeling of who Allah is, the very mention of the name brings this together. I can't even describe it. I hope my state shows it, right? So, Allah.
Subhanahu wa ta'ala. It hit me that in the case of Isa, the son of Mary, Isa ibn Maryam, alayhi salatu wassalam, the prophet and the messenger, the first thing that he uttered was, "Qala inni abdullah, I am the servant of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to love being referred to as Abdullah wa Rasuli sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, in hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that the best of names is Abdullah, right, and Abdurrahman. Some people say, okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has all these names. We said last time that there are many names. You know, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how many names he has. And the Prophet ﷺ specifically mentioned in one hadith, he mentions 99. That doesn't mean that he only has 99 names. So someone might say, why so many names? You know, what is the wisdom behind having so many names?
SubhanAllah, so first let's step back. I would say the following. One of the greatest meanings, and when you say the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
yeah,
I consider it the unification. And subhanaka ya Rabbi, you know, when you see so many things and things are so diverse, and even in speech, the ability to articulate, the ability to put big things into one small compact form is actually something very powerful. So the ability to say the word Allah, this word, if you expand it, it has so much in it. So for example, when I say Abdullah, as you mentioned, first I want you to notice the following. How do I define myself if I ask myself, Hassan or Joe, who are you? Who am I? Without Allah, I'm nothing. Ana Abdullah, right? Now Abdullah, like when you say the word Allah, Abdul Aziz, the Almighty. So I should not humiliate myself by doing wrong things. Abdul Hakim, the most wise. Abdul Alim, Abdul Rahman, Abdul Karim. You see, Sheikh, you can expand it. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and again, taking us to the second, Ya ayyuhan nas, antum al-fuqara'u ila Allah. O mankind, you are the one that are in needy. You're not self-sustained. You're like a vase. Built to be filled. وأنتم الفقراء, you are poor for Allah. Psychologists, you know, they study human needs and they say, oh my God, we need so many things. We need safety, right? We need sustenance, we need food, we need love and connection, we need certainty. When you look at it, أنتم الفقراء إلى الله. Now open Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with all the names. Oh, the one who feels insecure. You need a mu'min.
Is that why the scholars basically said, some scholars said that Allah is the name that encompasses all the other names and attributes all in it. And that's why some consider it to be Ismullah al-A'zam, the greatest name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
And you know, ya Sheikh, yeah, subhanAllah, let me, it's a transgress. Yani.
No, go.
Something is happening in the world of science also, which reminds me of this. Physicists, you know, like engineering, biology, all our advances, at the bottom of it is the science of physics. You know, the science that describes the universe and, you know, the physicists like Newton and what have you. And we have many theories, you know, some of them for electricity, some of them for magnetism, some of them for motion.
That's
and we
have different field right there.
subhanAllah, right? But we have different laws. No. You know, like there is the law of gravity. There is a law of electromagnetics, you know, Maxwell's equation for those who, you know. So each phenomenon has a certain law, right? And in the domain of physics, guess what they're doing? They're saying the universe is so orderly, there can't be so many rules like this. There has to be one. They call it the unification equation. Is there one equation, one line equation that you write that describes everything in the universe? They're searching for unification, unity, tawheed. How about la ilaha illallah? So in a way, the human being recognizes this, that beyond everything, all what you see is a manifestation of different dimensions, different side of the same thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that name that, as you said, encompasses all attribute, all beautiful things. Majesty, the way he creates is beautiful, the way he gives is beautiful, the way he raises is beautiful, the way he deprives is beautiful, the way he takes life is beautiful, the way he gives life is beautiful. To describe all of it, you know, words, you'll have words and words, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the one word. If you want to invoke all this, instead of, because if I say, Ya Hakim, Ya Alim, Ya Khabir, Ya Sabur, Ya Shakur, right? Beautiful. But when you say, Ya Allah, It's everything. Mm.
You're calling
all the attributes
with all the names.
Everything. When I want to do something, and I say Bismillah, you know, I want help, so I say by the name with who? It's not with al-Wakil, with al-Qawi, with al-Qahar, with al-Qadir, with al-Rahim, with al-Rahman, with al-Latif. And I go.
Allah, the one to whom belongs all these
everything.
Awesome, beautiful names.
وَلِلَّهِ أَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى.
Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah. You know, it also, I'm reminded of how when we are afflicted with calamity, we say, Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Inna lillah, right? So, we could say inna, I'm not saying we should, but what I'm saying, we're not told to say inna lirrahman or inna lil'afu or lil'ghafur, but rather refer to him by that proper name that encompasses all of these meanings. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. It is indeed a powerful name. You know, it fascinates me, subhanAllah, how much, as I'm saying this, I have to ask, our viewers, to look around wherever you may be sitting right now in your house. There is a very good chance that you have the name of Allah. You have, a lot of people have calligraphy as their, expression of Islamic art. And you're going to find it in many places, in many masajid, it's that name, Allah, and sometimes Jalla Jalaluhu next to it, is what basically we beautify, our homes with. And what I'm trying to get to is that, and when you look at it, yes, it looks beautiful the way it's written, especially when it's written with the thuluth, script. But if people can reflect and connect with it, it should actually have it in their hearts. It should actually beautify their hearts, right? No, and hopefully beautify their akhlaq, beautify their manners,
And yeah, subhanAllah, Sheikh, there is so many points. Like, even when we pray, I don't know if you guys reflected on this. You know the motions, the salah? Stand, Allah, then, Allahu Akbar. Then you make ruku'ah, right? And then you stand again and you make sujood. If you look from outside, we're writing Allah, alif, and then the ruku'ah, the lam, and then you stand back again, the other lam, and you make the sujood, the head. So like, even our motion in salah, you're writing. Can you imagine if I just thought about that as I'm praying, even my body motions.
Allah. Subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we know that the greatest statement or phrase is La ilaha illallah, right? It's the heaviest on the scale of the believer on the day of judgment. And that's why the Prophet said, Man qala La ilaha illallah, whoever says La ilaha illallah, dakhala al-jannah, right? And on the day of judgment, it will outweigh everything. And subhanAllah, in that great statement, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, says, La ilaha illallah, there is no God worthy to be worshipped except
Allah.
Not Al-Hakim, not Al-Alim. He is, because that name, Yadul, it actually leads to, and it encompasses all these other attributes and names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let me ask you a question. So someone might say, we need to get back to that question. So many names and attributes, what are some of the, some of the benefits of having so many names and attributes?
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beautiful in everything He does. Yeah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so infinite, so, right? So to encompass this in our humanly form, right? We need language and we need this diversity of experiences. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He created this universe, as we discussed last time, you can see in it the variety.
Subhanallah.
And this variety is coming from what you just mentioned, because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created the human, and people sometimes miss this. It's not that He created us, that He wants something from us. Because some people think worship is a favor we're doing for Him, astaghfirullah. No. He created us to give us. He's so generous, we were created to be given. And what Allah wants to give us is bigger than the world, is bigger than the universe. It's something the whole universe can't. He wants to give us knowledge of Him, an experiential knowledge of Him. Mm. And because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of His names again is what? Al-Wasi'. Vast, right? So that is so vast, so huge. It is so variant. And there's so many, if you will, now we can speak about the attributes and the different names, right? As manifestations, if you will, different projections of that name, you know? Mm-hmm. And to be able to get all this, we need so many things, because if you want al-Shakur and al-Rahman and the most wise and al-Alim and al-Qadir and al-Rafi' and al-Khafid and al-Awwal and al-Akhir, it's so diverse. It's never ending.
So each name, Yadul, you know, these names lead to or project or their manifestations of very powerful meanings that are, you know, key to our own spiritual health and to our also, you know, to how we're supposed to deal with one another. They are meant to inspire us, make us better people. You know, earlier you and I were discussing the matter of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala obligating us, right? Obligating us, you know, to worship Him or to do certain acts of worship, right? And we were saying that, you know, okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so, you know, so you know, he's all sufficient, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't need us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't need our ibadah. He doesn't need our worship. He doesn't need the acts of, you know, charity that we do. And but yet we are obligated by Allah the Almighty, as servants of Allah Azza wa Jalla, as ibadullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to do these things. You know, and you said something very powerful that I would love for you, inshallah ta'ala, to share with our viewers, inshallah.
Inshallah. I can do this the two ways. I can just go directly to it, or I can give the example we discussed. If you wanted to, you want a short version or a longer version?
Go for it, inshallah.
To reach that point, I'll just give you an example. And again, it's those things that happen around us, even experiences, not only created things, emotional experience that we have, it's a way to experience Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The love of a mother to her daughter, it's a way to experience Ar-Rahman. So everything that happens in our lives, when we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we see things in a completely different lens. And I to answer the question of Sheikh Muhammad, like, why obligations? Subhanallah, like, remember we said Allah created so many created things, but so it seems there are so many rules. You know, so it seems. Why? What's going on? What's the intent behind it, right? And to relate to this, I'm going to show you something. This happened to me. And we learn from everything in this life. Allah teaches us through. And I learned that from my daughter when she was 5 years old, right? So I'm going to share something with you that she did. And then an exposition to Allah's names and, you know, an experience, right? So will you allow me, inshallah, just to
go ahead. Our viewers should know, those obviously there are many people who love and follow Dr. Hassan Alwan. One thing that those of you who don't know him on a personal level, Abu Bilal, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him, there's always a reflection with every even little things that happen in his own personal life. You know, these gestures that sometimes we look at them and we ignore them, we don't really reflect on it, but he sees some deep meaning in it. So today, earlier, right? It was today, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Subhanallah. Yeah. You go ahead, you tell us.
So what happened is, when my daughter was 5 years old, she came to me one day and she gave me this.
This is so long time ago.
Yeah, like she was 5 years old. Okay, now she's like 18. Okay. Right? So, and if you, I don't know if you can see it, it's a drawing, and apparently that's her, and that's me. I don't know if you can see it, and there is, like, you know, hearts and what have you, and then it says here, you know, for Baba, and then I love you so much, yeah. Right?
So it doesn't look bad for a 5 year old.
You know. So when she gave me this, as any father or mother, what happened? I was so happy with it. You can see I kept it till now. But here is the reflection.
13 years, huh?
Yes, yeah, I still have it with me, right? And I'll tell you that the reflection doesn't end here. There is something very profound that happened, right? And I could have told her this, hey, wait a minute, I don't look like this. Let's be honest, is this a nice drawing? I don't have a green beard, do I? Do I, Ashif? And I could tell her, well,
it depends on who you ask, yeah.
And you can say, well, there is a spelling mistake here, right? But that's not what happened. Despite, it looks whatever, because it's the meaning, she loves me. Her abilities is that way. But because she loves me and she's sincere, that became so dear for me.
She expressed it.
First thing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, angels are standing on his door day and night, the likes of Jibreel, prophets, righteous people on his door with the most beautiful of dua. When I say Alhamdulillah, when I pray, my prayers compared to theirs would look like something like that, right? Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, although my prayers is really in place like this, it's nothing compared to an angel. But if I'm sincere, Allah would take it and say, hey, look what Hassan did. I hang this at my work. Look what I'm proud of it. I'm showing it to all of you. Look what my daughter gave me, right? Because of the meaning, because I love her, because she tried. But here is the interesting thing. So I saved it, right? And as she got older, I wanted to show my daughter what she means for me, how much I love her. You know, so now when she's 16, and so I tell her, Aisha, I want to show you something. And she said, do you remember this? Right? And what I expected is that she should be very happy. You know, oh, my dad loves me, you know. What do you think happened when I told her they remember this, Aisha?
She was probably embarrassed.
She was embarrassed. She was shocked. And she said the following, I can't believe I did this. My God, this is so bad.
Oh.
This is so bad. Baba, don't show this to anyone. So please, guys.
And here we are showing it to the world, mashallah.
Yeah. But she was so embarrassed and said, I wish I could draw better. I wish I was like better than this. This is so bad. And the first meaning, that's why a believer, when we pray and after salah, what do we say? Astaghfirullah, it wasn't good enough. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he does istighfar 70 times every day, because as you continue to progress, there is nothing befitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I learned a more profound lesson now. And this is the one that answered your question, Yashir, which really touched my heart. Now, imagine if my daughter did the following. Imagine if I go and I find my daughter crying. What's wrong? Said, Baba, I really need something from you. I really want something from you. Can you please give it to me? As a loving father, if I see my daughter crying and really in need, what would you do? What do you want, my daughter? And she says the following, Baba, please, it is summertime. Can you please, I want you to do this for me. Can you hire an art teacher for me? Okay. Yes. Why? Baba, my drawings are so bad. I can't draw you something properly. Please help me. Get me an art teacher so I learn how to draw so I can draw you a better picture. If she says this, what do you think will happen in my heart?
Oh.
So is this what you need? You need me to help you do something good like that?
Express yourself or your love for me.
Yeah. What's distressing you? Yeah. That you cannot do it properly? And you want my help to draw something? Oh, you will open. You can see what will happen to a father's heart or a mother's heart. You will be so, you know, and you'll comfort her. And then I thought about it, subhanAllah, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what breaks the heart of a believer is, wallahi, I'm telling you sincerely, ya Sheikh, is like, up till now, my prayers, ya Rabbi, none of them, not a single one is good enough. And I can sit and I can cry, tears, pain. What type of pain? I need help. I need help, not for food, to worship you. Show me. How? I'm but a human being. I'm but a kid. I don't know how. The biggest blessing you can ever give to me is that art teacher, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
What a beautiful note to end.
Now the answer to your question.
It's very interesting. He taught us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say Allahumma, you know, subhanallah.
That's it.
The hadith.
Inni
uhibbuk. I love you.
No.
And because he loved Mu'adh radiallahu anhu, he taught him something that has to do with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he says, لا تدع أن تقول دبر كل صلاة اللهم أعني على ذكرك وشكرك.
You see it, Yashir?
Yeah, subhanAllah.
So now you look to this and you see what? For a believer, therefore, when they ask, what is the best possible dua? And that goes now to your question, right? That's the shift. What? When we ask my daughter, if I ask my daughter, ask and I'll give you. She can ask for candy. She can ask for a new car. Now she's 18, right? She can, right? But what would be the best thing for her to ask? What would be the best thing to ask from Allah? Allah is very generous. Allah is al-ghani, very rich, very powerful. He can give. You can ask. The best thing to ask, they say, خَيْرَ مَا تَطْلُبُهُ مِنْكْ مَا هُوَ طَلِبُهُ مِنْكْ. And imagine a 5 years daughter. Just imagine that if I tell her, ask. And she says, Baba, I'm but a 5 years old kid. I don't know much. But I know one thing for sure. I know that you love me. And therefore, the best thing for me must be that which you ask me to do. You ask me to brush my teeth, that must be the best thing for me. You ask me to go to school, that must be the best, even if I don't understand it.
Whatever, in other words, whatever is going to make you endear me to you.
Exactly. And not only that, I know I'm a kid. I don't know what's good for me, but I know who you are. And because I know who you are, anything you ask me must be the best thing for me. Help me do what you want me to do. Allah. And that's what scholars said. The best ever dua for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the best thing to ask him is to ask from him to aid me do what he asked. Now the answer to your question is from the hadith, which is like the short version now, right? And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in this hadith Qudsi, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا تَقَرَّبَ عَبْدِي إِلَيْ بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْ مِنَّ افْتَرَطْتُهُ عَلَيْهِ. One of my servants, one of my ibad will not come closer, come into this, will not get closer with something beloved, this love relation, this close, intimate relation, with anything more better or more profound than that which I made obligatory on him. So when we understand that hadith, we say, okay, it means if I need to get closer to Allah, I should start with the obligations. Correct. But now it's the opposite way. Wait a minute, the hadith has a meaning that's different, which is what? Why did Allah make something an obligation? Well, let's look to this hadith again. It seems the following. Allah looked on different acts. There are many acts I can do. Allah selected the acts that are most powerful, most effective to bring us into this loving relation with Him. Then He said, you know what? Those things you have to do. He made it an obligation. So therefore, scholars said, أوجب عليك وجود خدمته وما أوجب عليك إلا دخول جنته. He made an obligation for you to service and to worship. And in reality, he's as if Allah is saying, you have to love me. You have to take my love. So if I leave you with no obligations, most of us will do nothing. And when he knew that most of us left ourselves, we will not approach him.
Unless we're obligated.
So he's as if Allah is saying, you can't lose on me.
Subhanallah.
And I left to yourself like a 5 years old, you'll not brush your teeth, you'll not go to school. I force you to go to school because you can't miss out on that.
Subhanallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those whom He loves, those who love Him more than anything else. Inshallah ta'ala, my dear brothers and sisters, we'll carry on with our conversation next time in a couple of weeks, inshallah, again. At the same time, inshallah, azza wa jal. This time, Dr. Hassan Alwan, we're going to be talking about the actual specific names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, beginning with, you know, the two most mentioned names, Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who are recipients of His rahmah. My dear brothers and sisters, it was a wonderful opportunity to be with you tonight. And Jazakallah khair, Dr. Hassan Alwan, for joining us again. Look forward to seeing you, inshallah ta'ala, in a couple of weeks. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakallah khair.
Wa iyaakallah barakatuh.